So let's continue on with visualization analysis and design, talking about spatial data. So we've talked about the idea that there's three different kinds of data sets: tables, networks, and spatial, and now is the time to focus on spatial data. So when we're thinking about how to use the visual channels of spatial position with both tables and networks, we think about expressing a quantitative attribute or separating into categorical regions and ordering and aligning. But now for spatial data, we're really going to focus on this case of using given spatial data. So when would we want to do this if the data set contains spatial attributes and they have primary importance? That is, the central task of the user really does revolve around understanding those spatial relationships. So that happens in contexts like geographic or cartographic data, typically in two dimensions, or some sort of measurements or simulations of the real world, like sensor data, simulation data. So let's talk through each of these in turn. We'll start with geographic. So what's going on with a geographic map, right? Here's an example of one. And what's crucial is that we understand that the marks on this map, these are interlocking marks. Sometimes these are called area marks, but they're not just area, their shape, their position. We can't move one without wrecking the whole thing, right? So we can't take Canada and move it over. We can't shape code it. We can't size code it. It interlocks with all these other marks. And so we can't take other attributes and encode them with those channels. They're taken. Now, in cartography, maps called thematic maps, where they're using the word theme to mean what we're here talking about as attribute, to show the spatial variability of some attribute where you care about the geographic distribution. So the way we can think about this from an analysis point of view is we are combining the geometry of some sort of geographic reference map with tabular data. So a region is two different things in these two different kinds of data. In one, a region is this interlocking area mark if we're looking at the boundaries like a province or a country. And it could also be a point mark, like if you've got a city or any other location that you specify as a two-dimensional latitude-longitude pair. In addition, we think of a region as something which is a categorical key attribute in a table, and we can look up some value attribute to encode. So this duality of it's a area mark and it's an attribute that we're using to look something up in a table. So let's talk about the major idioms for doing these kind of thematic maps: choropleths, symbol maps, cartograms, and dot density maps. Okay. So what's a choropleth map? It's where we color code stuff on a map. I'm sure everyone's seen these. And again, since we're using given spatial data, the central task here is understanding the geographic distributions, the spatial relationships here. And so the data is this idea that we've got geometric boundaries of these geographic regions. And for each one of those regions, we can look it up in a table and get a quantitative attribute. Here's an example of a choropleth map in D3. So for the encoding, for the position, well, we're using that given geometry of those area mark boundaries, and then we are color coding that attribute. In this case, we've got a sequential segmented color map, as we talk about in the color segment. It's going from min to max. Now, one thing to be aware of is spurious correlations are an issue. So the glorious XKCD has yet another appropriate cartoon for this. And so notice how we're seeing the same pattern in all three maps. Does this mean something about Martha Stewart subscribers? No, it's a spurious correlation because what we're seeing is where people live. And this is the thing about population maps. Think about when you need to normalize by the population density. If you just encode the raw data values, that's typically tied to where people live. But you often want to use normalized values where unemployed people per 100 citizens or mean family income or anything that is normalizing. This is not just about choropleth maps. This is a general issue that comes up all over visualization. When should you show an absolute count versus when should you show something relative, something that's been normalized? And so a really common error that you have to watch out for in visualization in general is failure to normalize, but it particularly hits hard with choropleth maps. So the recommendations, of course, only use these if you do need to understand those spatial or geographic relationships. You can see one thing at a time, one quantitative attribute. Normalize when it's appropriate. Do be careful when choosing the colors and the number of bins. So that's something I talk a lot about in the color segment. And a thing to notice is this works well when the regions are roughly equal size. That choropleth map we saw a moment ago, it was county level. It was not state level. Counties are maybe closer to the same size. Whereas, you know, Texas versus Rhode Island, we really have this issue that they're different sized. And let's think about why that's a problem. So what's nice about choropleths is they're easy to read. They're easy to understand. You don't need to do a lot of explaining. People get them. And often data is collected according to geographic regions, just like you might want to visualize that with. Now, there's some downsides. And one of them is we talked a lot with tabular data about how spatial position was this incredibly strong spatial perceptual cue. And we're just sort of using that up on the base of geographic location. So make sure the geographic location matters. But here's the key problem with choropleths. The visual salience of that interlocking area mark depends on the size of the region, and that might not at all match up with the attribute values, which is the true importance of what we're trying to encode. So the problem is that large regions appear to be much more important than small regions, and there's a lot of situations where that's simply not true, but that is the perception that we get. Also remember that the color palette you choose is going to have a really big influence on the result. So what else could we do? Well, simple maps are another option. So with simple maps, a symbol is used to represent some sort of aggregated data. Usually it's just a mark showing something simple or a glyph showing multiple things at once. And the key thing is this allows us to size code and shape code in addition to color coding. Sometimes these are called proportional symbol maps or graduated symbol maps. So in some ways, it's similar to a choropleth. We're using that spatial geometry and we're sort of keeping it in the background. And then we are encoding. So here we've got the point marks for state population. Here we've got this cuter thing of triangles depicting Christmas trees. But the thing to notice, well, they can overlap each other. So that's one issue. They can overlap the boundaries. So we could also show this instead of with simple marks, we could show this with more complex glyphs, like mini versions of histograms or of pie charts. So anything where if we want to show multiple attributes within a spatial region, then typically we would want to show that with a more complex glyph rather than a simple mark. So what's good and bad about symbol maps? Well, they're quite intuitive, maybe not quite so much as a choropleth, but still they don't take a lot of explaining. And they solve this problem about the region size versus the salience of the data, because the symbol can go according to the attribute value, not according to the region size. So you can have uniform size glyphs, you can size code marks. Now, there is that issue of there could be marks on top of each other. They could overlap each other, they could occlude region boundaries, and you might need a little bit of explanation for more complex glyphs. What else could we do? Well, there's a whole family of idioms called cartograms, and let's first talk through the contiguous cartograms. And we can see this on the right, we're basically distorting the sort of base shapes according to some attribute. So what is going on here? We can analyze this by remembering that these are these interlocking marks. We have shape and area and position. And what we have to do, we can't just change any one of them by itself, which is what I was talking about before, but we could derive an entirely new set of interlocking marks that combines information that was in the originals with this new quantitative attribute. And typically we're really gonna need to do this algorithmically, right? This is not something we do by hand, piece by piece. We have to do this in a global way. So given some input of the target size of this new quantitative attribute, then you try to have some sort of way to maintain the shape as close as possible to the original. And of course, we can treat this as some sort of set of constraints where we try to preserve relative position between regions, try to preserve the boundaries being contiguous between a region and its neighbor. And so we get these kind of results where, you know, we get the fat countries and the skinny countries. Now, these are really evocative. They're sort of intriguing, but they're also sometimes confusing. So what are some alternatives? Well, something that tends to be a little easier to read is a grid cartogram, And in this one, you basically say, I'm going to have a uniform size shape for each of these geographic regions. And I'm really going to worry about approximate spatial positions and relative spatial positions. So these sort of rectilinear grids don't have that kind of extreme geometric distortion that we saw before. So these are sort of stylized. So what are the pros and cons of cartograms? Well, they can intrigue, they can engage. And in the best case, when there's some really strong disparity between the expected size and the size in the cartogram, that difference will sort of really jump out at you. Those non-contiguous ones, like the grid cartograms or their cousins, things like hex bin cartograms, they're often easier to understand than those geometrically distorted ones. Now, the cons is you really need to know the base data set in order to have this work, because what's happening is you're comparing what you see to the memory of the base data set, the original. And so comparing a distorted mark you see now to the memory of what you saw before, that's something we're not so good at. You could mitigate this cognitive load on your memory by maybe having an animated transition between the states or show them side by side. Another fundamental problem is that distortion can be just plain ugly, right? Aesthetically displeasing. And maybe it's so extreme you can't even recognize the marks. Finally, it can be difficult to extract exact quantities. So if you really need to do precise reading off of things, a cartogram is not for you. So it's giving you much more overall gist information. And then finally, we've got this idea of a dot density map, where we're visualizing by having a bunch of dots, but the way this is different from a symbol map, it's sort of the inverse. A symbol map has one mark per region. Here, we're saying that one mark, one symbol, is representing a constant number of items. And so the dots are uniformly sized and uniformly shaped. We could color code something else if we want on top of that. So we don't need to use up the color channel when we're doing dot density maps. And we can see these spatial patterns and these clusters from, we can read off the density of the dots. And that is something that we're able to perceptually perceive. So pros and cons of these. Well, they're pretty straightforward to understand, and you completely avoid that non-uniform region size problem with choropleths. But you share another challenge with choropleths. The same normalization issues come. If you just show the raw data, you're going to see these population densities and typically not the effect of interest. So there's a perceptual issue that it can be difficult to just extract a quantity. Again, if you need a precise reading out of an attribute value, then this is not the right way to go. Also, there's a computational issue. Be aware that rendering a whole lot of dots could be slow, and you might end up with, you know, tens or hundreds of thousands of dots in a way that then could lead to some scalability issues. Now, anytime we talk about maps, it's useful to think about map projections. We talked about these in the segment on interacting with the view and navigation, and the idea that we've got some sort of camera projections. Here, we're specifically thinking about the projections of going from the Earth, of course, is a three-dimensional ball. And so the surface of that is a two-dimensional spherical geometry that we're mapping to the flat geometry of the plane. So we're going from a non-Euclidean space to Euclidean space, and necessarily those projections must somehow distort, whether it's angle or area or contiguity. So there's some great interactive tools for playing around with that. Belmonte has implemented Van Wyck's myriahedral projections. Jason Davies has a whole lot of D3 projections. So there are many ways to explore that space. We don't have time today to go into it in detail, but just to give you the tiniest taste, do keep in mind that the default for many, which is the Mercator projection, is gonna have huge distortion on the country sizes that get worse as you go from the equators towards the poles. So do be aware that there are many projections, and you should pick the one that's suitable for the task you have in mind. A great subject with a lot of algorithmic depth.